Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Culture Clash, a revolutionary new way of understanding the relationship between humans and domestic dogs. By Jean Donaldson. Narrated by Vanessa Daniels. Chapter 1. Getting the Dog's Perspective. Walt Disney vs. B.F. Skinner. A book published in the early 1990s refers to the moral code of dogs. It became a bestseller. It seems that most people still buy into the Walt Disney dog. He is very intelligent, has morals, is capable of planning and executing revenge, solves complex problems, and understands the value of the artifacts in Walt's home. Nobody wants B.F. Skinner's dog. The input-output black box who is so obviously not the furry member of our family. It's been marketed all wrong, I think. Skinner was right, but has gotten bad press. The truth must be presented in a way that people will start to buy into. They have to, because not getting it has led to the death of countless dogs. Here is an example to illustrate the difference. A dog has been reprimanded every time he was caught chewing furniture. Now the dog refrains from chewing furniture when the owner is home, but becomes destructive when left alone. When the owner comes home and discovers the damage, the dog slinks around, ears back and head down. Walt's view. The dog learns from the reprimand that chewing furniture is wrong and that the owner hates it. The dog resents being left alone, and to get back at the owner, chews the furniture when the owner leaves. He deliberately, in other words, engages in an act he knows to be wrong. When the owner comes home, the dog feels guilty about what he has done. BF's view. The dog learns that chewing furniture is dangerous when the owner is present, but safe when the owner is gone. The dog is slightly anxious when left alone and feels better when he chews. It also helps pass the time. Later, when the owner comes home, the dog behaves appeasingly in an attempt to avoid or turn off the harsh treatment he has learned often happens at this time. The owner's arrival home and/or pre-punishment demeanor have become a predictor. The dog knows he's about to be punished. He doesn't know why. There is no question whatsoever that the second view is the accurate one. The question is not which interpretation is the truth, but rather why anyone still argues the point. The medical equivalent would be a significant percentage of the American public thinking disease was caused by imbalance in humors, rather than microorganisms. The accurate information has been around for decades, yet most people who own dogs haven't learned it yet. One reason for our astonishingly poor understanding of dogs is extremely slow trickle-down from experts. Those in applied behavior educating one owner or one class at a time, rather than something on the scale of public service announcements or spots on Oprah. Not only is this missing, fantastically inaccurate information about dog behavior is actively disseminated on reality TV. But I think there's a second reason for the slow acceptance of realistic interpretations of dog behavior. Simple reluctance to let go of anthropomorphism. Behaviorism, made famous by Skinner, has suffered some serious backlash since its assault on the world of psychology in the mid-20th century, largely because it could be successfully argued that hardcore behaviorism comes up short for understanding humans in all their mega-brain complexity. When it comes to animal training and behavior modification, however, the fit is incredibly good. But so far, no amount of evidence makes the behaviorist model palatable to the average dog owner. The implications of this are really important. The impressive staying power of Walt's warm-hearted but distorted view of dogs is a perverse measure of how much we like them. We want them to be smart, morally good. Many cynics see dogs as superior to people in their loyalty and trustworthiness. By contrast, the behaviorist model hasn't caught on in the mainstream because it seems to reduce dogs to input-output machines. Our fear is that if we accept this viewpoint, we strip dogs of their status as honorary humans, with the logical extension of negative ramifications for their welfare. In other words, humans are tribal. Our compassion and consideration for other beings is strongly aligned with our perception of how similar they are to us, and a strong measure of that similarity is intelligence. IQ is still an acceptable prejudice. Heated ethical discussions ensued when the question of language acquisition in great apes was raised. Without a possible capacity for language, it had somehow seemed more okay to accept a utilitarian attitude towards them. No one much questioned the premise of intelligence as criterion for being considered for compassionate treatment. Our species has a long history of incredible violence and horror perpetrated, essentially because the victims were too far outside our perceived tribe. Our current tribal boundaries have a lot to do with species, IQ, and moral integrity. Our bond with dogs is obviously strong, but they are the wrong species. To explain the bond, we compensate by exaggerating how much they resemble us in the areas of intelligence and morality. This is a typical example of a bias or attitude coming first, and then edifices of explanatory facts or fictions being built in support of it. But things do change. I think we're more ready than we ever have been to accept the real species. We are now living in a culture that is much more aware of the concepts of tolerance and validation. Dogs are not like us. Not nearly as much as we thought, but that's okay. We can still bond with them, share our lives with them, and use them as surrogate children without apology. We don't have to build myths surrounding their nature to legitimize how we feel about them. They are valuable and fascinating as they really are. They don't need to be promoted in intelligence or morality to merit fair treatment or places in our families. Empathy and compassion for beings that are clearly unlike ourselves is a phase of ethical progress. Facing up to reality is important, not just because anthropomorphism has outlived its usefulness. It has always had a very real downside for dogs. Plenty of perfectly good dogs are insufficiently lassie-like to their owners and subjected to still legal sadistic training practices. The greatest gains for the welfare of dogs are now to be found in abandoning the Disney dog notion and replacing it with information from two sources: dog behavior and the science of animal learning. Indeed, it is our responsibility to be informed about the basic needs of the species we are trying to live with, as well as the vast and well-developed behavior modification technology available to us. If we achieve this, we can help them fit into our society without totally subjugating their nature. Lemon brains, but we can still like them. The two areas in which there is the greatest amount of myth and knowledge void are: 1. Dog behavior, i.e. the genetic endowment and constraints or hardwiring the dog comes with, and 2. Animal learning, i.e. the nuts and bolts about how experience affects the behavior of dogs and other animals, including us. Humans also learn through operant and classical conditioning. Classical and Pavlovian conditioning are the same thing. In this respect, we are like dogs. However, we, unlike dogs, are also masterful at learning through observation and insight. We have language to mediate our thoughts. We can move mentally from past to present to future and think abstractly. We internalize values taught to us, most of us developing qualities like compassion and a conscience, a sense of right and wrong. Behaving congruently with our values gives us self-esteem, a feeling of integrity, all of which swishes dogs completely. Dogs are completely and innocently selfish. They learn almost exclusively through operant and classical conditioning. Although some of their behaviors are socially facilitated, there is no good evidence that they have the all-purpose Swiss Army knife imitation tool that humans have. Here is the important point. This doesn't make them stupid or any less valuable than they would be if they could think more like us. In fact, dogs are great learners. They can discriminate extremely fine differences in their environment. They have incredible olfactory powers. They can deal with complex social environments. They may have a rich emotional life, but they do not think abstractly. They are amoral. They cannot move mentally forward and backward through time. And although they can learn to discriminate the relevance of certain words, they do not understand language. Let's examine our penchant for inflating the importance of intelligence and language in determining the worth of living beings. Psychologist Steven Pinker has noted that little money has been thrown at and no films made on the search for extraterrestrial marsupialism, or, for that matter, any other adaptation organisms have evolved or might evolve to make a living. We're looking for intelligence. Nobody stops to think that this is evidence of a bias. So while intelligence is but one strategy to gain evolutionary foothold, it is the only one we feel is worth searching outer space for. The jury is even out on whether our strategy will help us go the distance, long-term survival-wise. Pinker says, though language is a magnificent ability unique to Homo sapiens among living species, it does not call for sequestering the study of humans from the domain of biology. For a magnificent ability unique to a particular living species is far from unique in the animal kingdom. Some kinds of bats home in on flying insects using Doppler sonar. Some kinds of migratory birds navigate thousands of miles by calibrating the position of the constellations against the time of day and year. In Nature's Talent Show, we are simply a species of primate with our own act, a knack for communicating information about who did what to whom by modulating the sounds we make when we exhale. The Language Instinct, 1994. We all, publicly at least, denounce discrimination based on race, sex, age, or body size, but the tyranny of brain power remains and is ever so subtle. There are few more egregious insults than to call someone stupid. Ponder for a minute how you would feel about using rats in experiments to test drugs if it were discovered that rats are sophisticated, pacifist, psychic beings with IQs greater than the average human. If we still somehow had the might to perpetrate anything we wanted on them, it would raise insurmountable moral questions because our internal justification for using them has less to do with our might than the fact that, well, they're not very smart, are they? Dogs, like rats, are multi-talented, but they are also not very smart the way humans are. A recent book devoted to the intelligence of dogs is 250-plus pages long. Stanley Coren, The Intelligence of Dogs, A Guide to the Thoughts, Emotions, and Inner Lives of Our Canine Companions, 1994. Interestingly, despite careful qualifications by Coren regarding definitions, the ranking of breeds by intelligence literally made newspaper headlines. We are obviously fascinated by the notion that dogs, or at least certain breeds of dog, might be really, really smart. It all makes as much sense as evaluating humans on our ability to sniff for bombs or echolocate. We crave anecdotes about genius dogs, and these abound. Everyone knows a story that illustrates how smart dogs are, but a fundamental question has never been answered by proponents of reasoning in dogs. If dogs are capable of these feats of brain power at all, why are they not performing them all the time? Why never in controlled conditions? What is most tedious about these claims is the lack of rigor in evaluating them. It reminds me of people who leap to unlikely conclusions about things like circles in English wheat fields. Before theorizing that the circles were made by extraterrestrials, more likely explanations have to be ruled out, such as sophisticated pranksters. The latter turned out to be the case, but not before a huge amount of interest, not to mention a film, was generated by extraterrestrial theories. It would seem parsimony when evaluating possible interpretations is not mankind's natural inclination. Likewise, before jumping to the conclusion that the dog thinks abstractly and moralizes, first rule out an explanation based on operant and classical conditioning. I actually find it disturbing that my dog's value is based on myth and exaggeration, as though their reality wasn't good enough. Their value comes from their real beings, their dogginess. They don't need mental upgrading. They are worthy and wonderful as they are. So what is the fallout for dogs of the Lassie myth? As soon as you bestow intelligence and morality, you bestow the responsibility that goes along with them. In other words, if the dog knows it's wrong to destroy furniture, yet deliberately and maliciously does it, remembers the wrong he did and feels guilt, it feels like he merits a punishment, doesn't it? The word punishment here is used in its everyday sense. Those already familiar with operant conditioning jargon will recognize from the context that what I'm referring to is positive punishment. That's just what dogs have been getting, a lot of punishment. We set them up for all kinds of punishment by overestimating their ability to think. Interestingly, it's the cold behaviorist model that ends up giving dogs a much better crack at meeting the demands we make of them. The myth gives problems to dogs they cannot solve and then punishes them for failing. And the saddest thing is that the main association most dogs have with that punishment is the presence of their owner. This puts a pretty twisted spin on loving dogs because they're so smart, doesn't it? Learning theory, i.e. behaviorism, is the best means we have to understand and modify the behavior of our dogs. It is best both in terms of effectiveness and therefore, by extension, in terms of minimizing wear and tear on the dog and on the dog-human relationship. The large-scale unwillingness to accept and develop our expertise in applying the principles of animal learning is defended on grounds that don't hold up when scrutinized. The basis in science leaves people cold, yet the warm model, as we've seen, lays the foundation for endless punishments of these brilliant, moral, yet law-breaking beings. My argument is that dogs aren't demeaned or reduced to the status of laboratory rats by applying what has been learned by behavioral science. I'm incensed, in fact, by the incredible irony that zillions of rats and dogs lived pretty awful lives in laboratories and were subjected to zillions of rotten experiments in order to come up with basic principles of how animals learn. One of the most obvious applications of the knowledge so gained would be dog training, no? Kind of a double whammy for your species to be used in the experiments and then have the mass public ignore the results and continue to punish you because you're so smart. Of all the windows in existence to communicate with dogs, operant conditioning is the window that is open the widest. We should start using it. The eager to please fallacy. The anthropomorphic spin on dog behavior is not limited to exaggerations of their intelligence. We also misinterpret their regard for us. When are we going to put to bed once and for all the concept that dogs have a desire to please? What a vacuous, dangerous idea. I'm still waiting to meet this dog who wants to please his owner. Indeed, where is this dog who is interested at all in the internal state of his owner, except with regard to how manifestations of this state impact events of relevance to the dog? Actually, let's start by tracking down a dog who can form representations of another being's internal states at all. Although praise works as a reinforcer for some individuals, in the total absence of any competing motivation, this effect is limited and casts some pretty extreme doubt on a desire to please module. Closer scrutiny makes the case even weaker. Rule out, for starters, that the praise functions as a safety cue, a predictor of extremely low likelihood of aversives. This is evident in traditional obedience classes. The primary motivation is said to be praise. The primary motivation is actually avoidance of aversives, called leash corrections. If the trainer is any good, the dog learns that if a response is praised, a correction has been avoided, and so the praise acquires meaning and relevance. But does this mean the dog is employing this sound as evidence of some internal state of the maker of the sound? This is unlikely. Praise can also acquire some charge as a secondary reinforcer in the day-to-day life of a dog. People tend to praise dogs more before doling out cookies, attention, walkies, and games. This all is more evidence of what we already knew and should be exploiting with a tad more sophistication. Dogs learn by the immediate results of their actions and by tip-offs to important events in their lives. And yet the use of food in training meets moralistic resistance among a staggering number of owners. I once spoke to a traditional trainer who poured scorn on the use of food as a motivator. The line he trotted out, and which still makes me wretch even to this day, was, "If you use food to train, the dog is doing it for the food and not for you." This man's dog, trained by avoidance with a strangle collar, was supposedly doing it for him because the only positive reinforcer was praise. Trainers who make claims about dogs working to please or strictly for praise seem oblivious to the main motivator they employ: pain. The first task in training any animal is finding out what motivates it. No motivation, no training. All animals are motivated by food, water, sex, and avoiding aversives. If they are not motivated by these at all, they die. A lot of animals can be motivated by play, attention, and the opportunity to socialize with or investigate other dogs and interesting smells. All animals can be motivated by signals that represent one of these primary reinforcers, provided the relationship between the signal and the primary is kept adequately strong. This is mostly where praise comes in, as a sort of imprecise marker that tells the animal the probability of a primary has improved. If you opt not to use positive reinforcement, you end up, like they all do, using aversives and announcing that your dog is doing it for you. How pathetic. None of this is to say praise isn't good or important. I personally praise my dogs an embarrassing amount because I like them and I like doing it. They like it when I'm in a good mood because good things happen for dogs when she's in a good mood. I personally love it when someone like my kung fu instructor, who has power over me, is in a good mood, but not because I'm genetically wired with a desire to please him. My interest in my teacher's mood is pretty selfish, and I'm supposed to be a morally advanced human. Any interest your dog has in your mood is based on what he has learned it means for him, and that's okay. Praise does work as a primary reinforcer for some dogs. They like it enough to work for it, especially when it's the only game in town. But this is weak grounds on which to marginalize those dogs for whom praise does not work as a primary. It is also weak grounds to support the hypothesis of an underlying mechanism of desire to please. A lot of dogs seem to kind of like praise, but won't reliably work for it. This is fine. There's a difference between expressing affection to the dog for what it's definitely worth to the human, and for whatever it may be worth to the dog, and relying on praise as a principal means of motivating an animal in training or behavior modification. In other words, don't confuse bonding activities with training and behavior mod. For the latter, heavier artillery is usually needed. Some people feel disappointed to discover the necessity of using heavier artillery like food and access to fun and games and other primaries in order to condition their animal. They feel like their particular dog is a lemon because he listens when he wants to, only does it when I have a cookie, and has in short little or no desire to please. Generations of dogs have been labeled lemons for requiring actual motivation when all along they were normal. In fact, many people are actually put off by the intensity with which dogs will work for strong primary reinforcers such as food. It assaults any belief they might have in the desire to please myth and makes them feel less important to the dog. Wow, is this what motivation looks like? I'm still waiting to meet a real dog with desire to please. If he shows up, I'll send him for therapy. The desire to please thing has been fed largely by the misreading of certain dog behaviors. Dogs get excited when we come home, solicit attention and patting from us, and lick us. They are very compulsive about their greeting rituals. They often shadow us around when we're available and become gloomier or even anxious when we leave. They are highly social and genetically unprepared for the degree of absence from family members they experience in a human environment. They also bounce back amazingly well, to a point, from the immense amount of punishment we mete out at them. They monitor our every movement. I can see how this could be interpreted as worship, but it's important not to get a big ego about it. They are monitoring our every movement for signs that something might happen for dogs. My dog's brains are continuously and expertly checking out the behavior of humans, working out to 8 decimal places the probability at any given second of cookies, walks, attention, frisbee, and endless hours of deliriously orgasmic games with the latex hedgehog. They appear devoted to me because I throw a mean frisbee and have opposable thumbs that open cans. Not to say we don't have a bond. We are both bonding species. But they don't worship me. I'm not sure they have a concept of worship. Their love is also not grounds for doing whatever I say. It is, in fact, irrelevant to training. To control their behavior, I must constantly manipulate the consequences of their actions and the order and intensity of important stimuli. Interestingly, some of the most sophisticated training jobs are done where no love and little bond is present. This is not to say that training is not one of the best ways around to foster a bond. It is. But it's not a prerequisite of training. The dominance panacea. The other model that has been put forth as a quasi-justification for the use of aversives in training is pack theory. Ever since the linear hierarchy was postulated in wolves, dog people have gone cuckoo in their efforts to explain every conceivable dog behavior and human-dog interaction in terms of dominance. We really latched onto that one. It is a great example of a successful meme. Dogs misbehave or are disobedient because they haven't been shown who's boss. You must be the alpha in your pack. Aside from amounting to yet another justification for aversives-oriented training methods, the dog is supposedly staying up nights, thinking up ways to stage a coup, so you'd better keep him in his place with plenty of coercion. Dominance has provided a panacea-like explanation for dog behaviors. For the owner, this simple explanation makes unnecessary the work of boning up on a myriad of other topics, like how animals learn. Notions like dogs rushing through doors ahead of their owners, or pulling on leash to exert dominance over their owners, are too stupid for words. Some poor people have it so backwards that they view appeasement behaviors, such as jumping up to lick or pawing, as dominance displays, and thus fair game for aversive training. The dominance panacea is, once again, a case of leaping to a conclusion before ruling out more obvious explanations. Dogs chew furniture because what else could furniture possibly be for? They are disobedient because they have no idea what is being asked of them, are under-motivated to comply, or something else has won the behavioral gambit at that moment in time, like a fleeing squirrel. Rank is not likely on their minds. So, a separation has to be made between a dog behaving appeasingly and a dog being under aversive control. If you apply continuous shock to an animal after giving the recall cue, turn it off when the dog makes contact with you, and the dog learns he can escape and later avoid the shock by coming as soon as you give the cue, you have aversive control. You can do the same thing more clumsily, and many do, by using strangle collars or rolled up newspapers. This is not necessarily a dominance maneuver, however. How it impacts rank, if that exists, is up for grabs. Likewise, if a dog knows that he has a 1 in 5 chance for a reward if he comes, and that the great likelihood is he will be able to return to what he is doing if he comes immediately, and will in fact lose a few minutes freedom if he fails to comply, he's also going to exhibit a strong recall. This is control without aversives. What's important here is not what brand of motivation you use, avoidance or positive reinforcement, but the near total absence of bearing this has on the whole question of dominance. When most people say they have a dominance problem, usually they mean one of two things. They have a compliance problem, or else the dog is biting or threatening them. It may very well be in both cases that the dog's self-perception is that he is dominant over the owner. It could also be the case that the dog's self-perception is he is second to last in rank of all organic matter on the planet, yet is still undermotivated to comply and/or bites people. You could have a dog whose self-perception is that he is very dominant, yet is a world-class obedience dog and never bites or wants to bite anyone. If the problem is compliance, the dog can be successfully trained to comply using operant conditioning. This is the direct access means to modifying behavior. Using concepts like dominance to explain that a dog doesn't want to come when he has not been conditioned to do so, and had the behavior proofed against competing motivation, is needlessly muddying the water. You can flip him on his back all you want, and he will still fail to come if he's untrained and unproofed. And you can flip him on his back and hold him down all night and precede him through doorways, and he's still going to bite you if you set up conditions that push him past his bite threshold. There is a staggering lack of rigor and parsimony in the dog world, and the popularity of dominance as explanation is a prime example. Top 10 behaviors people attribute to dominance. 1. Biting/aggression, especially towards family members. 2. Pulling on leash. 3. House soiling, especially when accidents occur on beds, shoes, etc. 4. Chewing valuable owner possessions. 5. Jumping up to greet and pawing. 6. Failing to come when called. 7. Begging at table/pestering for handouts. 8. Going through doorways first. 9. Sleeping on forbidden furniture. 10. Food/laundry stealing. My favorite myth is going through doorways first. What silly person came up with the notion that a dog would understand, let alone exert dominance, by preceding his owner out the front door? When dogs are rushing through doors, mustn't we first rule out that they are trying to close distance between themselves and whatever is out there as quickly as possible because they are excited, because they are dogs, and because they have never been presented with a reason not to? Whenever there's this desperate grasp for why a dog does something, rather than being taken by a red herring like pack theory, first rule out: 1. Because it's being reinforced somewhere in the environment. 2. Because no one ever made a case to do otherwise, i.e., why not? The dominance panacea is so out of proportion that entire schools of training are based on the premise that if you can just exert adequate dominance over the dog, everything else will fall into place. Not only does it mean that incredible amounts of abuse are going to be perpetrated against any given dog, probably exacerbating problems like unreliable recalls and biting, but the real issues, like well-executed conditioning and the provision of an adequate environment, are going to go unaddressed, resulting in a still untrained dog, perpetuating the pointless dominance program. None of this is to say that dogs aren't one of those species whose social life appears to lend itself to beloved hierarchy constructs. But they also see well at night, and no one is proposing retinal surgery to address their non-compliance or biting behavior. Pack theory is simply not the most elegant model for explaining or, especially for treating problems like disobedience, misbehavior, or aggression. People who use aversives to train with a dominance model in mind would get a better result with less wear and tear on the dog by using aversives with a more thorough understanding of learning theory, or better yet, foregoing aversives altogether and going with the other tools in the learning theory toolbox. The dominance concept is simply unnecessary. So, What do we know about real dogs? Top 10 things we know about real dogs. 1. It's all chew toys to them. No concept of artifacts. 2. Amoral. No right versus wrong. Only safe versus dangerous. 3. Self-interested. Like all living organisms. 4. Lemon brains, i.e., small and less convoluted brains. 5. Predator ancestry. Search, chase, bite, dissect, and/or chew software in most individuals. 6. Highly social. Bond strongly and don't cope well with isolation. 7. Finite socialization period. Fight or flight when not socialized to some social stimulus category. 8. Opportunistic scavengers. If it's edible and within reach, eat it. Now. 9. Resolve conflicts through ritualized aggression. Never write letters to editor. Never sue. 10. Well-developed olfactory system. Chapter 2. Hardwiring. What the dog comes with. If you had to boil the preceding top 10 list down to two things that really captured the essence of dogs, it would be numbers 5 and 6. They are social predators. A lot of dog behavior can be traced to their evolutionary legacy as predators and as beings that lived constantly around others. It is true that dogs are not exclusively carnivorous. They can eat and digest a lot of vegetable matter and are keen scavengers. But there's a reason gerbils and ponies don't reflexively chase moving objects, whereas puppies and kittens do. Behaviors pertaining to food acquisition are, understandably, pretty deeply embedded. Even hundreds of generations of selective breeding that ignored, stylized, or even actively sought to eliminate predatory behavior in various dog breeds have failed. In the vast majority of individuals, to stop dogs visually tracking, chasing, and biting moving objects. Those same hundreds of generations of selective breeding also preserve the strong tendency to form social bonds and the rich array of affiliative behavior. Predatory behavior and its offshoots in dogs. The hunting behaviors that crop up in so many dogs derive from wolf biologist David Meech's wolf predatory sequence. Search. Find prey, mainly using nose. Stalk, stealthy approach to prey. Rush, move rapidly towards prey. Chase, if prey flees. Bite, hold, shake, kill, the prey. Dissect and eat the prey. There are two other behaviors that I would lump under the food acquisition constellation, though they are not found in fixed sequence. Chewing and food guarding. Both were sufficiently adaptive to ensure their presence in the repertoire of the ancestors of our pets, and both seem alive and well in a good many individuals today. Chewing keeps the crucial equipment, jaws, in good working order through isometric exercise. Dogs also can successfully consume bone as part of their diet. Food guarding was selected for in social carnivores because of the relative scarcity of food. By contrast to dogs, consider a herbivore who must consume vegetation 12 or more hours a day in order to extract enough nutrition. There's grass as far as the eye can see. It would be an ineffective strategy to expend energy guarding your daily acres from your confrere. Predators, on the other hand, invest an immense amount of energy in finding, catching, and hauling down a dense source of protein, and may not eat again for days. If you're a predator, you're going to make sure you don't lose your hard-won chunk of carcass, hence the strong propensity in dogs to food guard. It's compulsive rather than logical behavior. No matter how plentiful resources are made to appear, continuous kibble in the bowl, for instance, the dog's genetic program fires in a particular context, so the dog guards. Not to say it's not modifiable, It is. It is a common fallacy that behavior with a strong genetic basis is immutable. Modification, however, requires active intervention in the form of conditioning exercises, rather than simply resolving the actual scarcity by feeding to the point of obesity. The other reason dogs and many other animals can afford to engage in behavior like food guarding is that they have evolved highly ritualized forms of aggression. They are capable of aggressing without fatal or maiming force. They have, in fact, a huge spectrum of threat levels and means of resolving disputes that, although spectacularly scary looking to humans, result in minimal damage to the victim. This is also likely why some dogs' possessiveness extends to other things besides food. Squeaky toys, sleeping locations, Kleenexes or socks stolen from the laundry basket can all trigger guarding. There has been insufficient breeding pressure against ritualized level misfiring. If, however, a dog guarded Kleenexes with maim force bites, he hopefully wouldn't be bred. Predatory sequence behaviors. A great way to develop outlets for your dog is to come up with stylized games involving behaviors in the search, stalk, chase, grab, and hold sequence. Doing so is not just being an enlightened owner who meets their dog's needs. Providing this kind of stimulation on a regular basis is the first line of defense against behavior problems. What follows are suggested games owners can play with their pets to burn off that predatory energy. The choice of games would depend on the individual dog and the owner's preferences. Simply experiment and come up with a selection that best suits. Hide and seek. Put the dog in a sit-stay out of visual contact with the room where you will hide the object. For details on teaching sit-stay, see Chapter 6. Alternatively, you can simply shut the dog in another room to prevent him from peeking. Hide the object and then initiate the search by releasing him from the room, or the sit-stay, and asking him excitedly, "Where's your toy?" Then prompt and coach him to search. The object can be a cookie, a stuffed chew toy, a ball, or a tug-of-war toy. There must be some motivation for the find. If the dog is a maniacal retriever, a ball or other retrieved toy is perfect. When the dog makes a find, you may celebrate with a few intense retrieves before setting up another search. Likewise, if the dog is a tug-of-war addict, give him a 10 or 15 second round of tug as reinforcement for a find. Reinforcement is a more precise word than reward because it refers to a reward that by definition served to increase responding, as opposed to reflecting solely the intention of the rewarder. If he's more food motivated, use a Kong stuffed with something delicious. Start off with easy finds and big celebrations to get the dog hooked on the game. It only takes a few rounds for the dog to learn that he is looking for something of great interest to him. As he gets into it, go for tougher hiding places. As soon as possible, stop helping him to make finds so that he gains confidence in his own ability. If you constantly bail the dog out, he will learn that giving up is the most effective strategy rather than persevering. Most dogs will naturally begin to use their noses to make the find. This is magical to watch. At this point, they can find objects buried deeply into sofa cushions or anywhere else you might try to stump them. The main benefits of this game are 1. Predatory energy burner, both by making the dog use his nose to find and by working in some retrieve and or tug of war. Find it is the ultimate rainy day game. 15 to 30 minutes of it results in happily panting doggies, who otherwise would have their disappointed noses pressed to windows. 2. Teaches the dog to actively search for his chew toys. 3. Multiple rehearsals of sit-stay with excited dog. 4. Fun, the very best thing to have. Another variation of this game involves the owner hiding himself somewhere in the house. The disadvantage of this version is that it is more limiting as far as hiding places, whereas there are virtually limitless places you can hide a squeaky toy or other small item. You can also use this finding skill to help the dog kill time when you're away. Before leaving, plant cookies, stuffed chew toys wrapped in dissectable rags with multiple knots, and stuffed chew toys wrapped in rags enclosed in old margarine containers all over the place. Even the dog's meal in installments can be hidden around the house while the dog waits behind a closed door. Good sniffer dogs will crack virtually any hiding place you cook up. This provides constructive activity for the dog when he's alone and is a blow softener for him and guilt reducer for you, given that you're about to leave him alone. Please note that if your dog has an existing destructiveness problem, refer to the section on chew training as well. And if your dog has bona fide separation anxiety, you must get at the root of that. Retrieving. It has been long held that there are dogs who like retrieving and dogs who have no natural inclination. More likely, dogs who are strong natural retrievers have a stronger, indeed sometimes compulsive, inclination, whereas other dogs have it in them, but it's not as strong and or is buried deeper, requiring some awakening. Their apparent reluctance could be due to any combination of things. They are laid-back individuals in general. They have early histories of being punished or reprimanded for chasing and or putting anything in their mouths. They have histories of lots of coercive training and are globally inhibited. They have a history of understimulation and have a hard time relaxing and focusing when anything interesting starts happening. Or something in the immediate environment while training is stressing or distracting them. In formal training, many methods would advise force to teach these dogs to retrieve. In fact, some methods advocate force training the natural retrievers too. My point is not only that reluctant dogs can be trained with positive reinforcement to retrieve, but many will at some point, as though triggered, start to get into it. It will become inherently enjoyable to them. I've seen this time and time again. In fact, I've never seen it not happen, given enough time and an adequate approach. With a dog who is not interested in retrieving, it's important to obtain that first little spark of interest and nurse it along until it develops into a flame. The first spark of interest is likely to be visual tracking, following the movement with the eyes rather than actual pursuit. This is fine. Get excited when the dog watches the movement. Tease him with the object. Make it retreat rapidly from him. Play peekaboo. The sudden disappearance may trigger some movement from the dog. Again, this is to be encouraged. If you get any actual pouncing or attempts to bite the object, praise enthusiastically and try to get the dog to follow it as it moves, like a kitten follows a piece of string. Do as many repetitions as the dog is up for. The limiting factors are your own patience, how long the dog is in the room and interested in the game itself, and the reinforcers you are offering for nice responses. It's a big risk for dogs who are inhibited about chasing or picking up objects to actually try doing this, so it is extremely important that you give unambiguous and enthusiastic approval when you see the first tentative experiment. In fact, the first time the dog tries anything is always a critical juncture. A dog's early attempts at retrieve-like behaviors may have been squashed. The dog picked up something the owner would rather he didn't touch and was told off. It is only much later, after innumerable punishments for chasing bikes and feet, and for picking up shoes, Kleenexes, and garbage, that the owner tries to teach retrieving. A lot of chasing and object holding have been drummed out of the dog by then. A much better policy with young puppies, who will quite naturally chase anything that moves and bite all matter, is to direct this behavior towards predatory outlets from the start. If your dog has some punishment baggage, it may take time for him to loosen up enough to risk chasing and biting, so persevere. Once the dog starts blossoming, you can start shaping the desired chain of behaviors. An informal retrieve consists of a chase, pickup, carry, and presentation, putting it in your hand or dropping it nearby. In reluctant retrievers, each of these behaviors needs to be added separately, like pieces of a puzzle. One crafty and efficient shortcut is to develop an ultra-strong presentation using food rewards and then shape the other steps in reverse order, always leading up to the final step with its huge reinforcement history. Other trainers forward shape retrieves and get nice results too. Shaping is a technique that involves reinforcing the dog's best efforts and then gradually raising the standard until the behavior is as you wish. Most people's downfall when shaping is that they arbitrarily set too high a standard for reinforcement and ignore behaviors that are on the right track. For chasing, this might mean initially reinforcing even visual tracking. The foundation of shaping lies in the fact that behavior is always variable. If you decide, for instance, to reinforce the dog half the time, you will reinforce the better half of what he's already doing, however far that might seem from your ultimate goal. Over time, this differential reinforcement will push the average up, along with the cluster above and below the average, allowing you to differentially reinforce responses that are closer to the final product. Here is an example. Kurt, a golden retriever, is totally disinterested in retrieving. In his first training session, out of 30 trials consisting of the trainer teasing him and making an object move and disappear, etc., 18 of his responses consist of watching with mild to little interest and not moving. 12 responses are different. Of those 12, 7 consist of him not even looking at the object, sometimes even scratching, yawning, or walking away. These are the worst duds. But 5 of his responses are little nuggets of brilliance. One time he watched with greater interest, his ears going up, his head cocking. 4 times he actually moved. 3 times he moved tentatively in the direction of the object, and once he actually moved a bit quicker and tried to paw it. These responses are all reinforceable. The selection of responses is made using a clicker, a cricket noise-making device that informs the dog if the precise instant and behavior he has won a treat. More on clicker training in a bit. In the next training session of 30 trials, 2 consist of him not looking, 6 consist of him looking with mild to little interest, 13 times he follows, 5 times he follows and paws, twice he follows, paws, and mouths, and twice he pounces with some vigor. Kurt is starting to follow. An astute trainer may reinforce this several times and then see there are bigger fish to fry. The new standard becomes pawing and/or mouthing. A couple of sessions later, this dog is, with border collie intensity, exploding after every throw with a fast chase, grab and pick up plus a carry about 2/3 of the way back. The reinforceable response is now a perfect retrieve, all the way into the trainer's hands. What's amazing is not that this dog learned to retrieve and to love it, but that most people would have given up on him after that first session, or else failed to reinforce the mild interest and achieved a training stalemate. The behavior would have remained clustered around that initial average and may have even deteriorated through extinction. In any session, there are always going to be variations in the responses the dog gives. The trainer's job is to identify those that are reinforceable among those the dog is already offering, not those that meet some arbitrary standard the trainer has in mind, perfect retrieving, but those above average for that dog on that day. Individual judgment calls about whether to reinforce a given response at any moment are part of the art of training. Trial-to-trial judgment calls will get better with experience because more rapid progress after better calls will be a reinforcing event for the trainer. All training with positive reinforcement is greatly facilitated by using some signal that tells the dog exactly when he has won a primary, tangible reinforcer. Most sophisticated dog trainers use clickers, cricket toys, which have been previously associated with food reinforcement. Timing is absolutely everything in training. If the dog does a reinforceable pickup and carry, it's critical this behavior be marked for reinforcement instantly and not seconds later when he may be doing some other behavior. Delivering food reinforcers to dogs is not feasible in those kinds of time envelopes, so the click tells the dog that he just won and may now come to collect a reinforcer. The same system is used in marine mammal shows. The animals have been shaped to perform tricks, and the trainer's whistle tells them precisely when they have scored a mackerel. Improving presentation. Many dogs will chase with gusto and either fail to pick up and drop/lose interest, or else pick up and hoard rather than bring the object to the trainer. Improving presentation and retrieval stymies many people, but the principles are the same. In any series of carries or putter outs, there will be variation. Sometimes the dog will chase and not pick up at all. Sometimes the dog will pick up and run the other way. Sometimes the dog will pick up, turn, and drop. Occasionally, the dog will pick up, turn, and take any number of steps in your direction. The devil is in the details. Whatever is above average is reinforceable and will, if reinforced enough, become the new average, enabling you to set a higher standard. The best half rate of reinforcement is a rule of thumb. Some green dogs may need more, and savvy dogs can often tolerate lower rates. There is no limit to how tightly you can crank the standard, provided you do it gradually and follow the rules. These rules have been well laid out in Karen Pryor's outstanding.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.